here in San Antonio in 1968-69, Bobby Joe Phillips, a young black man here in San Antonio, was killed by the police and was never prosecuted. SNCC came to San Antonio with the Black Power Movement. So we just say this to let you understand that we do have a history on this issue. Okay, and we see it as our responsibility to try to educate the people in our community about dealing with the police. We're not saying that we're going to solve every problem that there is in regards to our relationship with the police, but we're saying that we might be able to save an incident, might be able to save a life with the correct information. At this point right now, before we go on with our workshop, I'm going to ask our county commissioner to come forward and give us a few words, and then we'll go to Mario Salas, who will be conducting the remainder of our workshop. Thank you.
Y'all don't know how blessed we are with that history. That is some powerful history. And upon the shoulders of the people of SNCC and the Black Panther Party, I stand today as your first black commissioner. There is no doubt that the movement was instrumental in the fight for equality here in San Antonio and Bexar County, and they continue. Many of the members continue to do wonderful works in speaking up and speaking out. I just wanted to come briefly and thank every panelist, every body who's come today, Mario and others who organized this. This is an important community discussion to know your rights. Of course, all of us who are maybe of ebony hue or growing up have had parents talk to us about how to conduct yourself and when you deal with law enforcement. But I remember getting my first driving while black during 1999, the Spurs went to the championships for the first time. And my friend, Raj Daniels, his mother was a colonel, and he knew that you could get finals tickets at the commissary over at Fort Sam. And so we decided to camp out in front of the commissary. We had, you know, our tents, we had our, you know. And so I went back, I was driving my dad's 88 Fleetwood Broham, and I went back to get some Cheetos or something at his house, that he wasn't too far from Fort Sam. And I was raised and taught that when you are on a military base, you don't speed. You know, you drive the speed limit or below it, you just don't speed. So I was extremely careful. And I remember looking at my taillights and making sure all my lights were working, all those kinds of things. Because, you know, I was a kid that was raised with the ACLU and with my father, civil rights SNCC, you know, member. So everything was A-okay. But as I go on New Braunfels Street, this is when it was open, when the gate was open, all of a sudden, a whole bunch of police lights come. And the next thing I know, there's probably six post police vehicles behind me and the wagon. Okay? And so I wasn't speeding. And so the officer said to me, your taillight was out. And I remember, I had just looked at it going into the house. And so, you know, it gave me the ability to go after, I guess, he realized that I was okay. I told him what I was doing, camping out, and he let me go. But I was pulled over. I was profiled. First time I was profiled. There's no doubt I was profiled. And at the time, I was actually working with the ACLU over at the Aerial House, and their former director told me, these are the things that you got to do whenever that happens. If one of the most common excuses that law enforcement use is that your taillight is out. And so what you do is say, officer, show me the defect. Okay? And you go and you inspect it. And if it's not out, you make sure you get that officer's badge number and file a formal complaint. And follow that process through. I'll tell you about the second time. After I ran for Congress and lost, I went in a runoff election to campaign for Cesar Rodriguez, and I was given Denver Heights. And there were some law enforcement that were kind of in the neighborhood, and I felt, you know, that maybe something could happen. But I was in khaki pants, a nice button-up shirt, I had my clipboard, and I was block walking for Cesar. Well, I kind of noticed some of the law enforcement following us, and I also noticed that there were a lot of Hispanic men on the front doors and out on porches while I was block walking. And so we eventually got pulled over, and the officer said to me, my sister was driving and I was block walking, and the officer said that we're looking for a Hispanic male selling drugs in the neighborhood. That's why I pulled you all over. So I got a walking one Hispanic in black. I didn't think anybody's ever had one of those. But that was a very interesting experience. And I won't tell you what I said to the officer, but there was no citation. You know, I don't know what drug dealer is walking around with a clipboard. You know, the role of county commissioner touches on the justice system. We obviously oversee the jail and the sheriff's department. And it was my honor to stand with you to get the body cameras for the first time in the history of Bexar County for all of the sheriff's deputies. And yes, they were dragging their feet. When they were dragging their feet, I called them out on KSAC. But we have a lot of work to do with respect to ensuring that all people are treated with respect and professionalism and service. Just this week, saw a Facebook post of a woman in Sunrise who her 15-year-old son was lost, and SAPD, two officers just ignored him. He was crying and thought he was just a thug, 15-year-old kid. And that loses faith and trust in the system. In our own sheriff's department, we have a horrible situation where two young African-American teenage girls at Judson High School were arrested, and their food was knocked down out of the Whataburger, and their hat was knocked over at the Whataburger. And I'm proud to say that I worked behind the scene to get those charges dropped. Those charges were dropped. I had a change.org petition against me, but I was already working on the issue. The issue happened on a Friday night. I had a friend who told me about it Saturday night. When I got home, I think I was at the mall, I went and looked at the video. I told my friend who knew the mother of one of the young ladies, I need to talk to the parents. And they had just gotten her out of jail. They were very emotionally distraught. They were tired, frankly, from being up all night. And so they asked that I call the next day. So I waited after church time on Sunday, and I called. They still didn't want to talk. I said, look, I really need to talk to you in order to help you and begin this investigation. So I listened to the mother and I told her that I would get these charges dropped if the video showed everything came out, you know, correctly. We have to do an investigation. So after that, I called the sheriff, former Sheriff Camaru. We had a conversation. I was not always satisfied that the sheriff was understanding the side of these two young girls. And I get along with pretty much anybody, but probably some of the toughest conversations that I ever had behind the scenes were when I fought for getting an African-American to be the project manager as part of a team at the AT&T Center, and the conversation I had with the sheriff. I'm not going to go into the details, but it was a very tough conversation that I had with her about how dissatisfied I was that, and what a waste of time it was to send these two young ladies who were on their way to a bright and prosperous future to a criminal record. Very shortly after that conversation, probably about 2 weeks later, those charges were dropped. So that's why the work and the legacy matters. I'm honored to be the first black commissioner, but when I leave, I want you to remember the things that I did to help people in our community get better justice and get a better county to work for them. That's what I'd rather you remember. So Godspeed in the work today to empower our community about our rights. This country, more than ever, needs all of us to tell the truth to power about what our rights are so that we may be treated with dignity. Don't think for a minute that the gains that folks like Abe and Mario have made will not see digression in the next couple of years. But count me in as part of the resistance. I'm ready to fight along with each and every one of you so that we can make sure that we are treated and given justice and fairness for all. So thank you for your participation today.
All right, of course, my name is Mario Salas, and we're going to do this. You should have a little thing here. Make a few adjustments. We're going to have two panel discussion pieces. And first off, I'll invite Claudius Miner up to come on up. And him and myself will talk about a few things. And then we're going to show a video. We're going to talk a long time. We're going to show, there's going to be about two or three videos, I do believe. So we're going to do that. Just give you a little bit of background information. Claudius and I were both members of SNCC. And SNCC in San Antonio was a very interesting organization in is that it's been called a hybrid by Professor Jones of the University of Atlanta because we were part Black Panther Party for self-defense and SNCC as well, so we were both. And during the time that we were members, we had official titles because most of the Black Panther chapters in the country and some SNCC chapters operated along military lines, so we had military labels or diplomatic type labels, depending on how you look at that. I was the Minister of Justice, and that kind of fit my personality, I suppose. And Claudius was the Minister of Defense, and you could might see why that fit. And then we had other ministers and so forth, and these are the titles that we use. I wasn't on that team of titles, but they play a role in terms of leadership, and that's what we try our very best to do. Let me just tell you a few things. The SNCC organization in San Antonio, we had a free breakfast program right here, right in this very building. We fed children in right next door in the cafeteria. We fed over 125 children free breakfast every morning. We carried them from their house, from most of them in the Southern Homes or Wheatley Courts. We carried them over to here, fed them in the cafeteria, and then we took them to school. In the afternoons, we would sometimes tutor them. This was all part of the SNCC and Black Panther survival programs. We had a legal defense program, we had a sickle cell anemia program, we had a free breakfast program. These programs that were designed to meet the needs of the community, and that was very important. At the time, we had a program here. It actually, thanks to the Freedom of Information Act, you find out a lot of things. Over the course of time, we knew the FBI was spying on us quite regularly. And of course, they were spying on everybody. They were spying on every Black. They were spying on anyone connected with the Civil Rights Movement. And they did that on a regular basis, either through electronic eavesdropping devices or people that would come to your meetings and were working with them, or whatever the case may be. And so, unfortunately, and I won't call any names, but unfortunately, there was one person who wasn't a pastor, by the way, here. But unfortunately, it was one person who convinced the pastor, because the FBI had convinced him to come to talk to the pastor, to remove the breakfast program from the church. So that was part of what Abram mentioned, Operation COINTELPRO, and that was to disrupt any Black organization or civil rights organization that was trying to make a real change in the community. So we had to deal with that. I discovered some of this on the Freedom of Information Act. And I did keep some pretty good notes at the time. So by process of elimination, I look back through those notes and know exactly who was going to the payphone and calling downtown to know what happened. But anyway, so all of that was a very interesting experience. We kept on doing what we needed to do. We protested the murder of Bobby Joe Phelps at downtown San Antonio, and we actually disrupted the Kings River Parade. We started off with about 50 demonstrators. We marched from the Victoria Courts to downtown right when the river parade was getting out. And by the time we looked around, we had made our way through the downtown area. I remember being on Navarro Street in front of the Knicks Hospital, and when I looked around behind my back, there had to be at least 10,000 other people, and they were chanting, they were saying stop police abuse. It was just unbelievable, spontaneous demonstration. Now, the day after that, I think it was the day after that, and Claudius might want to speak to that, for a couple of days after that, our office was raided. I don't know, 200 or 300 police officers, because we had had the Dallas police, the Dallas SNCC chapter had come to San Antonio to help us out if we needed any help. And in those days, there's nothing like being young. In those days, we armed ourselves. We brandished weapons, and they were loaded. So the SNCC chapter from Dallas came down here, and they had all kinds of, I'd never seen some of that kind of stuff. They had a Browning automatic rifle, they had a vehicle, they had a BAR, they had all kinds of weapons. And they stood out in front of the SNCC office, and while we were having a meeting upstairs, they guarded the office. So the police waited until they left. They attacked our office, and many of the members were arrested. I'm going to stop there because I want Claudius to say a few things about some of the stuff that he experienced, and then we'll move on from there. So, Claudius, take the mic.
Was that just a term from the Army? And the year before, a little girl that got shot downtown by a police officer recklessly discharged the shotgun. One of the pellets struck her. And in the sword discussions, I decided, hey, no more. But as Minister of Defense, my job was education, as far as I was concerned. We had to educate ourselves how we could do electronic, just said. We had to know the right way to do it and the wrong way to do it. My job was to keep us alive long enough to get what we wanted done. And believe me, we could have died very easily. They wanted us dead very badly. And when he said they raided our office, that was no joke. There were police everywhere, shot. Matter of fact, they had me handcuffed across the car with 2 shotguns across the car. But it is what it is. And that's what we do. And the people that decide to do that are special people. You guys are very special people because you decide to be here and you care. And that's all that matters is caring and informing yourself. If you do it wrong, you messed everybody up. And you may die. And there's a difference between the police department now and then. And one main fact is militarization. You are, until you prove otherwise, ISIS to them. Mm-hmm. They're trained by the same people. They train the FBI, the same people give these seminars all to all the police departments, and you are the enemy. You have no rights. And on that point, if you don't know your rights, you sure don't have any. You must know what you can and can't do, what other people can do and what they can't do. And as we learned in the movement back in the 60s, your very life depended on it. It was nothing glamorous about it. It was dirty, day to day. You couldn't keep a job. As soon as they find you working, they go to your boss and you get fired. But we kept on. The objective is to make a change. If you can't take care of yourself and educate other people in affecting that change, it's all useless, it's all worthless. You are the forefront of this movement. You chose to be here. You chose to be somebody. You chose to educate yourself. You chose to share your knowledge with someone else. That makes you very important. And I just want you to remember that you, all of you, are the movement. Someone asked me one time at a seminar at a college, what would I do if I found myself in charge of a national organization, thousands of people, what would be the first thing I'd do? My response was, I'd educate everyone to be me, to be the leader. You don't want to be a leader, you want to be among leaders. You're no good if you can't think for yourself to do the things you're supposed to be doing without asking someone. You got to man up, you got to be the man. If that's what you want to do, you got to do it. I hope you carry something from this meeting. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank
I too would like to recognize Reverend Kemp for being here and allowing us to be here, and give him another round of applause. And he don't want that, but let me tell you, it's really priceless. I'm glad to see him too. Because look, we've got pastors in the town, and only a few of them, blessed are concerned about civil and human rights. And the ones that are, I applaud them, and we should applaud them as well. We have a video, I believe, we're going to show, if somebody could crank that up, on the 10 minutes. And just before we crank that up, or get it on the screen, we were very, very much concerned about the city of San Antonio and the things that have taken place. We are very much concerned about police officers. And somebody the other day told me, and this was his response, he said, "Well, I back the blue." And I said, "Me too, but I don't back the food." I said, "So there's a difference between backing the blue and backing the food." I said, "So don't lump in the food with the blue, because there's enough of them to give all of y'all a bad name. And anytime you have a police officer that's violating people's rights, he's actually putting the other police officers' lives in danger."
Absolutely.
And I don't know what the problem is. They need to think about that. I did have one earnest police officer tell me once, I have a problem with the guy that they've assigned to me. I don't want this guy assigned to me. I treat everybody fairly, and I don't get on anybody's case. This guy's always causing trouble." And I said, "Well, did you file a complaint?" He goes, "Yeah, I did." So there are some police officers that have actually filed complaints against other police officers. And national statistics show about 57% of the black police officers feel that the Black Lives Matter movement is a good movement. There's another percentage that don't. When the statistics also show that about 7% of white officers think Black Lives Matter is a decent group. So we have this big difference of opinion within the ranks of the police themselves. We have a police advisory board that takes complaints, and in my opinion, it's absolutely worthless. It actually is, because the community is not represented on there like it should, nor do they have the power. They don't have subpoena power. They don't have contempt power. They have no way to actually, and a police officer that's being charged before that board can actually refuse to testify. So what's the purpose of the board? And I would say it's cosmetic. We've gone through this cosmetic stuff where they come up with all these nice cosmetics to sound good. We have been having these meetings, and I'm being very critical about some of these other meetings that have taken place, to better police community relations. Well, we're all in favor of that, but no one wants to talk about that no good police contract that took the accountability out of the contract. There's no accountability in that contract anymore. So a police officer that did something a few years back, that can't come up in a new disciplinary hearing. So we can't look at a pattern that may have been established by this police officer, a continuing pattern of disrespect and violations, because now in the police union contract that's not allowed. Come on, man, as Barack Obama would say. Come on, man. What person in his right mind would say that's accountability or that's just? It's not. So we still have that problem to deal with, and we'll continue to do so. My last remark before we go here is, a police officer said to me, I think all lives matter. And I said, well, in that case, you don't have a problem with Black Lives Matter. So what are you trying to tell me? Black lives never matter. Other lives always matter. Black lives never matter. So that's why they say Black Lives Matter. So, and if you're saying all lives matter, then that must include Black lives, or something wrong with you. Because for you to say that as a juxtaposition or in opposition to what I'm saying tells me something about you. Now tell me what you're trying to say. And he actually backed off and said, "Yeah, I'll point there." I said, "I know I do. That's where it's coming from."